People kind of have a much higher bar for what is acceptable or what is high quality content simply because they have a lot more access to different kinds of or different formats of content.
Hello everyone, welcome to the 7th episode of Pepper Spotlight Podcast. My name is Pawan Rochwani and I'm the host of this show. Before I tell you all about who the guest for this episode is, let me just remind you all that Pepper Spotlight is now a weekly podcast show and you can listen to us and watch us on every Wednesday. You'll find us on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Hubhopper, Gaana, Anchor, JioSaavn, whichever podcast app that you use. Just search Pepper Content or search Pepper Spotlight on those apps and you'll find this podcast show. If you don't find it, you can even just Google Pepper Spotlight Podcast and our website will pop up and show you that. This week at Pepper is going to be full of stories. Why I say this is because the guest of today's episode is also somebody who's building a big platform for Bharat about stories. And plus, this Saturday, we are hosting a master storyteller on Pepper Social. On 20th of March, Saturday at 4 p.m., we are hosting Roshan Abbas, who's the founder of Come In India and also MD at Geometry and Compass. He's a master storyteller, somebody that I thoroughly admire in the creative space. He's an investor, he's an entrepreneur, and I think a brilliant conversation is going to happen this Saturday at Pepper Social. We're going to attach the link to the event as well in the description of this episode. And it's a free to attend event. It's on AirMeet. Just block your calendars for Saturday 4 p.m. Now, why I'm saying this entire week is going to be about stories is because this episode is also with someone who is building a platform for stories. I remember in 2018, this platform had 50, 60,000 writers on their platform. And now in 2020 and 2021, they have more than 320K writers who are writing different stories and articles and poetries on their platform in 12 different languages. And every year, every month, they are adding more and more writers and more languages also to their platform. Recently, they also acquired a whole podcast segment onto their entire group and also a comic segment. So now it's not just about stories, it's also about audio stories, podcasts, and even comics. And I think every day they produce 8,000 content pieces. And it's a massive number. Imagine a social media account producing and publishing 8,000 content pieces. I mean, I cannot even imagine how that would be, but this platform is creating so many stories and so much of content in different languages for Bharat. I'll tell you all why I'm using the word Bharat here instead of saying for the country or even for globally, because they also have Hindi and English stories and content. But let me introduce you all and get into the conversation with Ranjit, who is the co-founder and CEO of Pratilipi. If you want to know more about Pratilipi, I'm also going to attach the link to their website, to their app, to their social media accounts in the description of this content. But let's get into the conversation with Ranjit. And this conversation was pre-recorded over a Zoom call a few days before releasing this episode. Let's get to know what Ranjit has to say. Thank you so much, Ranjit, for joining us on an early morning to record this conversation. I really, really have to say that everyone at Pepper has been a big fan of your work and everything that happens at Pratilipi, because it's a space that we are very excited to see how it unfolds in the next few years. I want to begin this conversation with asking you something that's very much misunderstood even now, although there have been so many articles, so many conversations, so many podcasts about the same phrase, but something that's still really misunderstood in the ecosystem is, what does the term really building for Bharat mean? And I think when this term comes out on the internet, Pratilipi is one of the organizations that really stands out and, you know, is an example of building for Bharat. So if you could start the conversation with telling us about what Building for Bharat means, that would be great.
First of all, thank you for having me here. In my opinion, Building for Bharat basically simply means building for like the India, irrespective of what languages they speak and irrespective of what where they live or what language they are accessing the internet in. I think a lot of times people kind of try to over-specify everything. So there are terms like Bharat 2, Bharat 3 now. In my opinion, it's basically very, very simple. If you're building a product that has a little bit more of a universal appeal, instead of just targeting the top 50 million or 100 million people, then you are essentially building for Bharat the way people kind of describe it. And that's basically it. There's not much else that changes.
So it's nothing relevant to, you know, it has to be from tier 2 city or tier 3 city, or it has to be only in Hindi or anything like that, right? Because that's the usual misconception that's floating around, that if it's Hindi, that means it's building for Bharat.
Yeah, exactly. So for example, for Pratipi itself, we have about 3% of our users who come from outside India, and there are about 48-49% of users who come from top 7 cities. And I don't think anybody would basically say that Pratipi is not a Bharat product. So I think these are just misnomers and not necessarily correct.
That's it. I mean, this is something that I find very interesting and inspiring also. How did the idea of starting Pratipi really come to you, and how was the process of that?
So the real story is basically a little bit filmy. So I was born in a very small village in Raebareli, Uttar Pradesh, less than 1,000 population village, almost nobody knows English. When I started pursuing my engineering, I was one of the first engineer in many, many villages. And I'm a voracious reader, so I used to read like 130, 140 books a year. And when I went to pursue my engineering, I realized that Hindi content was simply not available as much, either offline or online. I shifted to reading English, but I also started cribbing to my friends that this is not how it should be. It should be my choice or my decision if I want to read Hindi or English or some other language. Didn't really do anything about it at the time. Went and pursued my MBA from Faculty of Management Studies, Delhi, then worked at Vodafone for a couple of years. And there I found my job a little bit too easy and comfortable. So I quit my job and was trying to decide what to do next. And then some of my friends to whom I had cribbed in the past, they basically called me back and said that nobody else is solving this. Why don't you go ahead and solve this? I thought kind of makes sense. In fact, these people, basically the people that I had cribbed to in the past, they became our first few team members as well. And that's how essentially Pratipi started.
And from the first two people, now how big the team or, you know, the writer base or the reader base has become? Can you share that with us?
Sure. So from a team perspective, we are now about 120 people. This is including the acquisitions that we have made. So like everybody in Pratipi family. We have about 320,000 writers now who write in 12 languages and about 24 million monthly active users.
And how many content pieces are getting generated every day when there is like such huge pool and number of writers that are there on the platform?
So roughly about 8,000 stories are published on Pratipi's platform. This is the literature platform. Mm-hmm. And comics, FM and IBM are still relatively small. So there the number would be more in double digits or triple digits.
Wow. And like 8,000 content pieces in different languages are going out every day on the internet. Right. That's a very huge number.
I would say that it's a good beginning, but there's a long, long way to go. You would expect that in the next few years, we should have at the very least 100,000 plus stories published every day. So I think it's a good beginning, but there's a long, long way to go.
Wow. And how has the consumption trend been? Because as you were saying, Hindi content was not really available during your engineering days or a few years back, but now the content is available in Hindi, Marathi, Malayalam, Telugu, Tamil, any of these different languages. So are people from these languages now used to consuming this kind of content, or they are used to English or let's say Bollywood or Hindi, that type only?
Honestly, I think we still don't have as much content in Indian languages as we should, given the population. Even though I think a lot of companies, both startups and larger companies, have been working on increasing both the breadth and the depth of Indian language content. But I think we are still a far way away from like having enough supply to match the demand that we have. So right now on Pratipi alone, for example, we have like about 9 million stories that are read every day. And even then, like, I'm very, very honest or upfront about it that we don't have nearly enough supply compared to how much demand we have. I think like there's a long way to go before we can have enough content for the new internet users who are coming online.
Got it. And something that I want, like, just like a small sub question about it to, you know, really understand how the whole process or let's say the operations work here. So how do you decide like which languages you want to start creating content now, or let's say start onboarding few writers about this particular language? Is it, you know, are you understanding some data trends or, you know, something that's going on the internet? How do you decide if you want to start something in the Telugu or Tamil segment?
So it's a combination of things, generally deciding on when to launch which language. But it's basically, if you look at it, it's a combination of three things. One is, what is the inbound demand that we have? So like, are there people who could be writers or readers who are reaching out to us and asking us that when are you launching this language or that language? And we really want to read it in this language. So that is like inbound demand on Pratlipi itself. The second is essentially the macro trends, like how big is that language in terms of number of speakers, internet users, what is the like habit of reading in that language? And the third, which is probably the most important one, is that what kind of skill set do we have in our team with respect to that language? So do we really have somebody already who can launch that language and take it from zero to one? So it's probably a combination of these three in deciding which language to launch next for us.
And what about the writers? So is there anybody can start writing on the platform, or there are certain criterias for it, or how is the onboarding for, let's say if I want to start writing, so I'm a Sindhi. If I want to start writing stories or, you know, let's say articles or news in my mother tongue, how do I go about it?
All you do is you download the app, you sign in and you start writing. That's basically it. So think of Pratlipi how you would think of something like YouTube. Like anybody can be a reader, anybody can be a writer, anybody can be a podcaster, anybody can be an audiobook creator. There are literally no restrictions.
So like, and there's no content moderation or guidelines or things like that that we have to abide by, or any rules that as a writer or let's say as a creator we have to abide by?
So there is, of course, the terms of service, just like any other platform. So for example, you can only upload content that you own the copyright to. You cannot write something that is illegal in any different way or form. For example, you cannot do copyright violation. You cannot write hate speech and things like that. A lot of this is kind of algorithmically monitored. And anytime like the first mistake is identified, the content is deleted and the writer is banned. Second time a mistake like this is identified, the creator's account itself is suspended. But as long as what you're writing is legal and as long as you own the copyright to what you're creating, there is no other restriction.
Got it. And same is for, let's say, people who are in the comic space or podcasting space, or for them it has different rules?
So comics and podcasts are still relatively newer products. So comic, for example, right now is not UGC. You actually have to reach out to us and we have to approve what you are creating before it goes on to platform. But that's more of a function of getting to a enough liquidity stage. So when you're just starting a company, you want to make sure that your recommendation is not working very well at that point. So you want to make sure that you have enough high quality content so that people have something to consume and so that your recommendation gets better. So maybe in under 3 to 4 months, we will make comics as well UGC. Within podcast, we actually have two different products. So one is Pratlipi FM, which is more UGC, where anybody can come and create any kind of podcast or audiobook that they want. The other one is IBM Podcast, which is more of a PGC or media play. So there, essentially, all the content is created by IBM's team, or at least like created in supervision of IBM's team. So there, like normal people generally cannot come and create a podcast.
Yeah, and like, just to let you know, the very first episode of this entire podcast series was with Amit, and that was the time when exactly the acquisition and the deal was happening, and the news just broke out that Pratlipi has, you know, IBM is going to be part of the Pratlipi family. So very, very congratulations about that. Can you tell us about, you know, moving from how Pratlipi works, now I want to ask some questions about you as an entrepreneur and, you know, how you have led the organization. How did these expansion ideas into the podcasting space or let's say comic space, you know, really happen? Where was this always the plan, or it, you know, just came on to becoming? How was it?
So in our case, at least even before we started building Patlipi, or even before I kind of convinced my co-founders to come and join us, I was very, very clear that what we wanted to build was a storytelling platform across languages, devices, formats, geographies, and things like that. So we wanted to make sure that any format of storytelling in any language, in any geography that people wanted to share their stories in is something that we would kind of want to support. As an early stage company, of course, you have to kind of keep your focus because otherwise you are stretching yourself too thin. So for the first 4.5 years or so, we basically just focused on online literature. But we were always very clear that any format of storytelling, as long as stories at the heart of it, is something that we would be interested in. So it was just a function of time in terms of when we launched comics or when we launched audiobooks or when we launched podcasts.
And how are the users, you know, let's say behaving towards it, like people who are just reading articles or stories or let's say news on the app, are they now also switching to checking out the comics or the podcasts that are listed, or how is it, or the readers just read and the listeners just read? How is that user behavior happening for you?
So before that, just a clarity that all of these products are actually separate products. So for example, like Pratipi Comics is a separate product, Pratipi FM is a separate product. So even though some content would be available on our literature product, but a lot of product might only be available on the exclusive Pratipi FM or Pratipi Comics product. So generally what we have seen is that there is some overlap on the demand side. Like there are some people who listen to audiobooks on Pratipi FM and read Pratipi Comics or read Pratipi Stories. But the real overlap is on the supply side. So creators or the story a lot of times remains same or at least remarkably similar. And then it is just adapted to a different form. On the demand side, there is some overlap, like 20 to 30% overlap. But a lot of users are actually essentially new users who prefer a different format. So that is what we have seen till now. It might change as we scale, but let's see.
Got it. Can you tell us about some of the top creators who are there on the platform, and you know, how did they start, where they are currently, and you know, how do you see it going?
I'm not sure if I'm the best person to answer this, to be honest, because at least last 2.5-3 years, I have kind of unfortunately have had to move away from operations and move more towards like customer acquisition, growth, and product. Having said that, when we started building Pratipi, there were some writers who joined us within the first 1 year, and some of those are still very, very active on Pratipi, and they have become kind of like our brand ambassadors. So I can talk about some of those writers. So one of the writers, for example, is Abhida Sharma. She is the writer behind Meri Avantika as well as Canvas Ke Rang, both of which are two of the most read stories on Pratipi. Similarly, we have a writer called Manmohan Bhatia, who joined us like within the first week of launching Pratipi, and he has published like 100 plus stories on Pratipi. So he has been a published writer in the offline world for a long time. It's just that in the offline world, generally your reach is very, very limited because of how economics play out. And on Pratipi, he has been one of the most read writers. Then we have a writer who unfortunately passed away, I think last year, but he was one of my favorite writers called Vijay Kumar Sapatti. He used to write a lot of suspense and thriller. And like, I think if we look at top 300, 400 suspense and thriller stories of Pratipi, probably at least 5 or 6 or maybe even 8 or 10 would be by Vijay Kumar Sapatti ji alone. So a fantastic writer again. And probably my favorite writer who doesn't write as often on Pratipi, but I think is probably one of the best modern writers that I've read, a writer called Shimurti. So he's a very old established writer. He would have published a lot of books and a lot of articles in the physical world. But some of his stories on Pratipi are absolutely mind-blowing. So one of my favorite stories on Pratipi is a story called Kuchhi Ka Kanoon. And I think just a fabulous story in general and a fabulous writer as well.
I'm going to, as soon as, you know, this conversation done, I'm going to check out all of these writers and the stories that you're referring to. Something I wanted to ask you out of, you know, my personal experiences, I have had a hard time moving from paper books and hard copies to, you know, ebooks, and now it's also audiobooks, and there are, you know, shorter formats of books also, let's say the series or the Wattpad kind of, you know, writing culture that's going on.
How have you seen, you know, the consumption trends on Pratilipi platform of, you know, are people switching from, you know, those audio from the main books or to ebooks and to audiobooks, or how has the consumption trend been?
So first thing first, I think a lot of experts say a lot of things and vast majority of times they are actually wrong. So for example, for a long, long time, people have been saying that, you know, people's attention span is going down and people have the attention span of a goldfish and so on and so forth. That's simply not true. So people still binge watch Game of Thrones, for example. People still binge read Harry Potter or Lord of the Rings. What has happened essentially is that people kind of have a much higher bar for what is acceptable or what is high quality content, simply because they have a lot more access to different kinds of or different formats of content. So now if you want people to kind of go through a long content, then it has to be above a certain like quality and it has to kind of match their expectations. That is the only thing that has changed. The second thing is that I think people kind of are always on the lookout for great stories and great entertainment. It's not primarily about the format. Having said that, of course, different people would have different preferences. So I think what we, as well as most other entertainers in the market essentially do, is that we try and tell the great stories in different formats, and then basically let the people decide which format they are more comfortable with and what they want to consume. So there would be people who are like, who prefer reading comics, there would be people who prefer watching movies, there would be people who prefer reading long books, there would be people who prefer listening to podcasts, and all of that is okay as long as they're consuming great stories. So at least from our perspective, that's how we operate. We don't try and force people or even encourage people that you should do this or you should do that. Our thesis basically is you should have the option to decide and making the decision that what format works best for you.
Got it. I think I'm going to come to my second last question. And then the last question is more like a lightning round where we ask you some quick questions. I really wanted to know and understand how did, you know, the organization and you also as an entrepreneur took up this 2020 year as, I mean, this was like a very challenging and a very weird space altogether for everyone. So how did the organization and also you as an entrepreneur, you know, face this and how did you tackle this or maybe made the most of the year 2020?
Right. From a business perspective, actually, because Pratilipi is almost entirely an online internet company, which meant that, like, if anything, it was probably a slight positive for us, and there wasn't really that much of a negative that we faced, unlike companies that had a physical operations element involved. But 2020 was still very, very, very challenging for us, primarily because we as a company have a weird culture. So our employee NPS, for example, is one of the highest in the world ever. Like, our employee NPS has almost never been below, I think, 70, and it's usually between 70 to 85. In any survey, including internal or external, that we have done. But that was very, very hard to maintain when people were simply not allowed to come to office. And we spent a lot of time figuring out how to kind of manage people's psychologies and motivation when you can't really meet them, see them in person. So one of the problems of having a good culture like Pratilipi essentially is that people treat their colleagues as an extension of their own personal life as well. And it becomes very, very complicated when you can't really see them, you can't play cricket with them or chess with them. So we spend a lot of time in managing people's mental psychology and mental well-being. I think that was probably the number one priority for me, like across the year 2020.
Got it. Anything that's all of that conversation that we have had till now has been, you know, just putting me, I think one of the most key takeaway for me was that, you know, people don't have the attention span of a goldfish. I think people are just craving for better stories like Game of Thrones or whatever, Lord of the Rings or Harry Potter. And it's just a matter of how well you can, you know, create those stories and distribute those stories. Ranjit, I'm going to come to the lightning round, and which is like a quick set of questions. I mean, not like the Karan Johar types of coffee with Karan type of questions, but yes. The very first one in this is, what is your go-to regional language content that you consume these days?
I'm not sure I understood. Platform?
So is it like Hindi, Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam, which is like the regional language?
I can only read Hindi and English, so it's Hindi.
Okay. Do you prefer listening to podcasts or do you prefer listening to audiobooks?
Neither. I'm more of a reader.
What are top three books that everyone should read, or let's say top three stories on the Pratilipi platform that everyone should read?
I think depends on the genres that you like, but in general, I think Kuchhi Ka Kanoon is something that you probably enjoy quite a bit, irrespective of who you are. I think reading, like if you're interested in romance, then reading Meri Avantika would probably be like a really good experience as well. If you like horror, then I think reading the trilogy, which starts with Murdunga Train, might be good.
Got it. What are three things that you do when you are not working?
So I spend 10% of my time in helping others. A vast majority of that would be other founders. So I think that takes up almost entirety of the time that I'm not working. The second would probably be I watch or listen to like an esports called Age of Empires. So I used to play that a lot when I was in college, and I still watch it or listen to it at least. And the third would basically be just reading something somewhere. Could be Twitter, could be Medium, could be Quora, could be something else.
Got it. And there's the last one, because, and this is something that I want to ask you. A lot of entrepreneurs, or let's say people on the internet, tell content creators what they should do. But what are, let's say, three things that they should not do during their content creation process?
I don't know, man. I am not an expert in either creating or editing or figuring out what works best. So my advice basically would be just keep an open mind and let the world teach you. That's probably it.
Super. I think that's a very great advice altogether. And Ranjit, thank you so much for giving us your time today. I think this has been like a great, great conversation, and everyone is going to, at least, you know, we'll put the link in the description of these episodes about all the, you know, writers that you have referred to and the platform as well. And I think thank you so much once again for giving us your time today.
Thanks a lot for having me here. It was a pleasure.
I hope you enjoyed this conversation with Ranjit. If you're a writer, podcaster, storyteller, comic artist, I think Pratilipi has a lot to offer to you. Just check their website or their social accounts to know more about how you can publish on their platform. Now, coming to why I am saying this entire week at Pepper is also going to be about stories, is because we are hosting a master storyteller, Roshan Abbas, this Saturday, 20th March, 4 p.m. at Pepper Social. The link to attend this free virtual event is in the description of this episode. Please go ahead and just block your calendars for Saturday 4 p.m. and we'll talk more about stories and creativity in general on Saturday. Once again, to remind you all that Pepper Spotlight is a weekly podcast show. We release new episodes every Wednesday on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, JioSaavn, Hubhopper, Anchor, Gaana, any other podcast app that you have. Just search Pepper Spotlight or Pepper Content, and I think you will find this show. Thank you so much once again. And if you have any suggestions, guest recommendations, any questions that you have for us, just feel free to DM us on Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. We are present almost on all platforms. So like, just feel free to DM us @Pepper_content. My name is Pawan Rochwani. Thank you so much for listening to this episode, and we'll see you again on next Wednesday. Thank you. Take care.